Good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2023. Just for the benefit of colleagues, our first agenda item is to agree to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private when we'll be considering revised guidance and written submissions. Are members happy to take those items in private? We are. Fine, thank you. Agenda item 2 is consideration of continuing petitions. And the first of those is petition number 1876 to accurately record the sex of people charged or convicted of rape or attempted rape. And this petition has been lodged by Lucy Hunter-Blackburn and Lisa McKenzie and Kath Murray. And I'm pleased to welcome Lucy Hunter-Blackburn and Lisa McKenzie to the committee this morning. Good morning to you both. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to require Police Scotland, the Crown Officer and the Scottish Court Service to accurately record the sex of people charged or convicted of rape or attempted rape. And we last considered this petition here at our meeting on the 22nd of March when we agreed to write to the Scottish Crime Reporting Board, the Police Scotland, and also to invite the petitioners to give evidence. And before we move to the substance of today's consideration of the petition, I should note that the committee has received responses from the Scottish Crime Reporting Board, Police Scotland, as well as further written submission from the petitioners responding to those responses. The Scottish Crime Recording Board advised in their response that their remit is focused solely on the police recorded crime national statistics, which measures crimes, not people, and have never included the recording of demographic details of suspects or perpetrators. Police Scotland indicated the review of its recording policy is progressing through its internal governance processes, and if approved by the Professionalism Strategy and Engagement Management Board, will be subject to wider consultation with relevant stakeholders. Police Scotland also carried out a manual review of its recorded crime data for rape. They state that although they are unable to confirm the biological sex of those recorded in the statistics, and I quote here, none of the females recorded for the crime of rape were involved in the physical act itself. In all cases, their involvement was art and part, defined as aiding and abetting or abetting in the perpetration of the crime. And so in light of these responses and the evidence gathered throughout the consideration of the petition, the committee have a number of questions we'd like to explore with the petitioners today. I wonder whether there's anything you'd like to say just in advance of us so doing. Yes. Dr. Lucy Hunter-Blackburn.
Yes, thank you. If it would be helpful, convener, yes, we could.
Quite happy for you to make comments.
Our petition was lodged, of course, on the 7th of June 2021, so 2.5 years ago. So we want to thank the committee, first of all, for pursuing this so diligently and going into the various organisations that has. You've accumulated in the course of that a lot of material and a lot of questions you could ask, but we want to say our point here is very simple. Rape is a male crime. And when a man rapes a woman, he should be recorded always in all the statistics as a man, as a male person. So that's our most important point behind all the detail that we could explore this morning. We want to start there. So it's a long-standing failure to deal with this issue. Police Scotland's policy on crime recording generally, not just specific to rape, was raised by Joan McAlpin in the Parliament in March 2019. And the then Justice Secretary gave a reply which I regret to say I would call specious. We noticed female rape in the 2018-19 criminal proceedings data. We asked Scottish Government about it, and they told us they had to check newspaper reports to see if it was right. And later they said they'd amend the stats, and we noticed they have yet to do so. So there are really four points that we think matter here. One, it's trust in statistics, that these are important statistics and they need to be right, and the trust in statistics, public trust in statistics, rests on them being solid and reliable and correct. There's a point about responsibility. A lot of your paperwork, a lot of your exchanges really are watching public bodies play ping pong with this issue and fail to take responsibility. This is not difficult. Police Scotland have the ownership of their stats. They should own this decision and they should just make it, and they should be asked to make the right one. There's a moral obligation to victims. Very strongly, Michelle Thompson made that point very forcefully to the committee at an earlier stage. It is not acceptable that a victim of rape, who could be a man as well as a woman, but predominantly we're talking women, should have to see the state, the system, rebadge a person who raped them as a woman when they know fine well it was a man. And behind this as well, we see in the Andrew Miller case illustrates this really strongly. Andrew Miller was recorded as a man because he chose to be. We have that on the court records. Andrew Miller, who was arrested wearing a prosthetic bra.
Slightly careful here. Yeah. We obviously have to be quite careful about the discussion of cases that are actively live in court procedures at the moment.
Yeah.
And the one to which you're just referring is. So I'd be grateful if you just perhaps didn't refer specifically to something that is a matter of sub judice.
Shall I talk about his conviction, which is not under review? It's only his sentencing that's under review. But his conviction for sexual assault is not, he's not challenging the conviction, just the sentencing. Miller was arrested wearing women's underwear. He was known in his community, Amy George, and he was allowed to have himself recorded as a man.
I do think it would be better to try and talk in general terms about the policy, because I just am worried that we in any way that might be seen to be prejudicing any wider consideration of these issues.
Understood, convener.
I understand how difficult that is, and the timing of when anything takes place is always a factor in these matters. But we aren't immune in this building
in the way that
they might be at Westminster, unfortunately.
Well, what the point I would like to make is, without naming a name, we have evidence, convener, that it is open to individuals who have been convicted of serious sexual assault to choose whether to be recorded as a man or a woman. We think that is Police Scotland. Well, we had the outgoing Chief Constable said that the force was institutionally sexist, and we cannot think of anything much more misogynist than a man being able to choose whether he's recorded as the sex he is or the opposite one. We think that's wrong in this context, in these kind of cases. So that's where we'd like to start. Lisa, is there anything to add to that? No, that's where we start from.
Okay. Thank you very much. Yeah. And I'm going to invite my colleague Fergus Ewing to lead the questioning. Mr. Ewing.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to witnesses, and thank you for appearing. The committee was, as you've alluded to, keen to give you that opportunity and also to hear what you have to say. I think you perhaps have kind of answered this already, Dr. Blackburn, but could I just ask anyway, what is the aim of the petition? What would you like to see happening? I mean, you've made your views very clear, and I'm grateful for that, but what I'm curious to know about is, what would you like to see happening, and what in particular would you like to see changed?
Right, well, I suppose the main thing that the committee, and we are really grateful for the attention you've paid to this, because the system feels very impenetrable to people. It feels very difficult. Where do we go? You write to public bodies, they bat it around. What we would like you to do is to provide the ethical leadership here, which is lacking. It's lacking from Police Scotland, it's lacking from the government. We'd like to see the committee provide the ethical leadership, which says to these bodies, A, somebody, you own this. You own the recording of your statistics. And secondly, we'd like you to agree with us that this matters to get right and that the recording of rape should be done. Sex and what else is recorded about perpetrators is fine. We're not saying you shouldn't record anything else, but that their sex is clearly recorded. And that when you look at the female offending statistics, what you're seeing is the offending statistics for women.
Ethical leadership. I mean, at the moment, my understanding is that it's Police Scotland has the primary responsibility for accurately recording sex of suspects. What's your view about that? Are you happy with that? Is your view that you're happy with that, but that they don't carry it out in a way that you regard as displaying that ethical leadership?
Well, ultimately, it's the police that record the data at the point of arrest and charge, so it quite clearly falls to them operationally. I mean, one point I make about the Scottish Crime Recording Board, I hear what they say about they were set up for a very specific purpose, as I understand it. There was a set of crime data that they own which were de-designated as national statistics in 2014-15, and they had to rectify that. But the fact of the matter is, crime statistics that they collect, yes, they're right, they collect statistics on crime, but the same statistics will be used for criminal proceedings about the people. So someone who commits three crimes will appear in the criminal proceedings as a person, if you like, and under the crime data as the offence itself. So it seems odd to me that the board can't choose to have a little bit of oversight about this, and the board is chaired by the Scottish Government. But, you know, there's a pointing game going on. But Police Scotland, yes, probably they have the primary responsibility.
Are you happy with that?
I think so, but I mean, at the end of the day, as Lucy said, it's about ethical leadership, and Sorry, and what we're seeing, not just on this issue, but related issues on the sex and gender issue, is the failure to take leadership. I mean, without going off into a divergent issue, we have schools guidance in Scotland, and it's problematic from the view of lots of women who've been campaigning on this issue. But what you get from the Scottish Government is, well, it's just guidance. It's non-statutory guidance. But that guidance is being used once there's a kind of naivety, once it bears the imprimatur of the Scottish Government, people take it seriously, quite understandably, and schools will adhere to it. And we've seen that. We've seen councils say, well, we're doing this, we're changing these toilets to gender-neutral toilets because the guidance sort of suggests that's a good way forward. So there's a naivety about what it means when a high-profile public body like Police Scotland or the Scottish Government put their badge on the kind of the norm of collecting data in this way. And we had data, guidance from the Chief Statistician in September 2021, which basically said that public bodies could stop recording data on sex as a matter of course. Now, we see that as enormously problematic across all sorts of different public policy areas. But interestingly, the one thing that the Chief Statistician drew out was said, well, investigation of crimes is actually one area where maybe it is important to collect data on biological sex. But that seems to have been overlooked by Police Scotland.
So your concern really isn't so much who's legally responsible for recording the sex of suspects, but it's that there is a sort of an abnegation of responsibility on the part of the Scottish Government. And instead of giving very clear instructions, they give guidance which is vague, perhaps for political considerations.
Sorry. yes, I think that's... Right, OK, I've just realised that. OK, yes, I think that's fair, yeah.
I'm just really trying to get to the root of, you know, your views and also what you think should happen so that we can then consider matters in the light.
If the Scottish Government was to say, we think it's imperative that you record the sex, the offenders, rapists, then I'm assuming Police Scotland would probably do it.
Yeah.
I hope they would.
Maybe perhaps I could add one thing, which is that there is a sort of domino effect in the system here, which we notice, which is once the police do it, then the courts do it, then the media do it. So there's a kind of, the system is linked, and the police are important because they are the first point in the system at which a person might be misrecorded by sex. But of course, you can take someone like the Isla Bryson, Adam Graham case, and you'll see that in his case, he was recorded initially by the police as male because he hadn't, at the point of being arrested and originally charged with rape, he hadn't at that point adopted his cross-sex identity. So he is, but then later when he goes into court, the pronouns change, and then you, even today, you could hear Rona Hodgkiss talking on the BBC to someone and a journalist saying, well, we're using she because that's what the court used. So there's a sort of a domino effect, but the police are the first part, the first domino, if you like. So the system does link, and you have to take an interest in what everybody does, but guidance and leadership from the Scottish Government would certainly, in because of that linkage, would simplify it in that sense.
Right. Now, obviously, and I'm not going to mention any particular cases here, Convener, but there may be instances where a rape suspect, self-identifies as a trans woman. And many people, including myself, may think that they are frankly at it and bad actors, although that's my personal view. But given that this is happening, what is your view? Or it's happening in a few instances, happily a very few. What is your view about how these cases should be recorded in respect of the identity of their sex? Presumably, your view is that these are men and they should be recorded as male. Is that it?
Yes. I mean, absolutely. That's exactly what we think. I mean, we're not saying that there is no reason to record anything else about them. And we're not. I mean, Lisa and I, we like data. We were very supportive when the census added the question about trans identities. We thought that's interesting because we hear and know little about the population of people who identify as trans. So we are absolutely, if the police want to record other aspects of this person, how they identify, they might want to do it because they feel in order to handle them in custody, for example, that they need to know that. That's fine. That's absolutely fine. We're not arguing against that data being recorded as well. And in the grand scheme of things, there's a huge amount of discussion in this area which is hampered by a lack of data. And being able to say yes or no to how many such cases existed, being able, without having to comb the press,
to say how many of such cases as you're describing exist would help everybody, no matter where you stand in the argument, because information is helpful. So we're absolutely clear that we're not arguing that you mustn't also record that if you wish to, but the fundamental point is that this person should not go into the stats as a woman.
I mean, it's just listening to what you've said and the explanation you've given, for which I'm very grateful. Just to put this point to you, I mean, is your concern not really so much about the precise sort of dry technical rules about how sex should be recorded, but the fact that there has over recent periods of time been cases where men who've carried out rape self-identify as women, and that instead of them being recognised as men, the state is taking a wishy-washy, mealy-mouthed approach and can't actually spit out that they are in fact men? Is that not really your concern? Rather than a sort of question of the recording of statistics, it's more of an ethical or political view that you have here, because we have to consider where we go and what we do with this, if anything. And it does really strike me, and I don't mean in any way this to criticise the view that you take. I probably share your views as I understand them, as you've expressed them this morning. But what it does seem to me is that what you really want is for society to display a very clear approach that a male rapist is a male rapist, rapists are men, and that's that. And those men that pretend to be women, as you see it, are at it. Now, if that's your view, is that not really more a matter of politics than the recording of statistics? Because many members of the public may say, well, it's pretty obvious that all rapists are men, so what's the point of... We all know that already. And if they say that they self-identify as women, well, that's a matter of self-identification, but it doesn't change biological sex.
So we have more than one reason for wanting this to change. I mean, one is a sense of a moral duty to people who are the victims of sexual assault and rape. But the trust in statistics is very important. It's what it... Because the statistics that are gathered generate an understanding of offending patterns, and sexual offending is by and large perpetrated by men. Now, we've seen in the criminal justice proceedings, we picked up this one female rape in 2018, 2019, went to the Scottish Government, they said, oh, that looks odd, we're going to look at newspaper reports. This is not a sustainable way of running a data collection exercise. But if that trebles over 2 years, then suddenly it looks like there's been an explosion in female rape. And it's not as if that data just sits in the ether and we don't do anything with it. I mean, you've been a minister, you know that this is foundational for public policy making. Public policy making and public resource allocation is made on the basis of data. So if we suddenly see what looks like an explosion in female rape or female sexual assault, then we might want to divert public resources to deal with this new phenomenon. But actually, it turns out it isn't a new phenomenon. It's actually a male offence committed by males. And that's what we should be dealing with. So it's not just that the ethical thing is one part of it, but trust in statistics is really fundamental. And already we're seeing, people are concerned about misinformation perpetrated because of the advent of social media. But this is really important, that the public has trust in statistics. And if they read a Daily Mail headline which says there's been a trebling in the instance of female sexual assaults, can we be sure that that's really what's happening? Is that the phenomenon that we're really faced with? Or is it that the data now has been skewed? I mean, Police Scotland reviewed the 28 cases that they came across between, I think it was 2012 and 2018, of, I think it was suspects and those... arrested with female rape. Yeah. And their response is, well, they were all art and part, but that's not what we were asking. How do you know for sure those 28 people were biological females? Because once you've changed your data collection practice, that's what you've lost. You can no longer say with certainty those 28 people are male or biologically male, biologically female. And that's what gets lost if you change your practice.
What if I could add something? Some of the language that you're using there, I'm very uncomfortable that the response to the Bryson case was that you had to say Bryson was at it, that was a political response. From my point of view, when we're talking about this, I'm not words like pretending or whatever. It's just a fact. This is a male person. What that person, what what that person genuinely believes about themselves is a separate question in this context. I'm not wanting to make that kind of judgment. It's a simple fact. The crime has been committed with a male body by someone who I would describe as a man, but I'm not asking anyone to make a judgment about, in every individual case, whether we're going to use a phrase like "at it," which I don't think is particularly helpful here. We just need to say it's a male person. In any such case that might arise, what the relationship of that person is with the identity which they profess is a completely different question and will vary. And I want to be careful here that this is not, the argument here is not we should do this because people are quote unquote at it. We should simply record them correctly by their sex because they're male.
I mean, I guess the background to that view is that there's a feeling that some individuals may seek to be housed in female prisons. And in that sense, the motive for professing female gender is one which most people would regard as bogus. So, but I take the distinction. I mean, I just saw one more question, really, Convener, for the witnesses, which is really what you would like to happen next. You've already said that ethical leadership is what you require from the government, from the police, from those who record statistics, but are there any more specific things that you would like done in response to your petition?
Well, I suppose it's simply what it says, please. When we thought about this when we started, would the Parliament ask the government, essentially what the petition says, will you please ask the government to ask the police and the other bodies concerned to do this, I suppose, is our fundamental simple request.
Right, and, yeah. And the government's response, which is it's up to the police, is an abnegation of leadership.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, this is the problem, it's the kind of perpetual finger-pointing, it's not me that's got responsibility, it's them. I'd like to know why Police Scotland believe it's consistent with their so-called values to hand rapists the power to determine how they are represented in public statistics. I mean, this has been the consistent response that the police have given to the media, that this is aligned with their values. I find that quite incredible. And in April 2019, the police were asked by a feminist campaigner, why have you changed your recording policy? And they said, and when did it change and on what basis? And they said, well, it evolved. And then the Deputy Chief Constable wrote to the Justice Committee in January 2022 to report that actually, later that year in 2019, they decided that they would have to, the reason for changing the practice was in anticipation of the GRA being reformed. So this is a very common phenomenon as well, as public policy running ahead of law reform, which of course none of us can guarantee will happen or come to fruition. And we've seen this with other public bodies. So Police Scotland casting around for a rationale and retrofitting it and changing it, perhaps when they come under scrutiny. But I would like to know why they think that this policy is consistent with their so-called values. I find that quite shocking.
Do you like us to find out?
That would be great.
What are the police values to which they refer? And why have they resulted in a change in the previous practice? They're matters which, to many of us, seem fairly straightforward and always have done for decades, if not centuries. Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Maurice Golden.
Thanks, Convener. I'm quite keen to establish whether the recording of crimes, the related data, and indeed the databases are, if there is a general issue or a specific issue. So it's my understanding that police officers will often record details of a crime in different ways, depending on, even though we have a singular force, they might record the data in, particularly once you get down to granularities, in different ways. And indeed, there's not even a central database which covers all the recording of that data that is universally shared across Scotland. And I just wondered, the committee may choose to find out, but I just wondered if you had any insights into this.
No, in the sense that Police Scotland would have to give you the answer there. But I suppose one reason that rape was the issue of the petition, although I think we wouldn't deny that the same arguments were making you could add to, you know, serious sexual assault and violent crime, all the crimes that women very, very rarely commit and men do, and where the statistics would be skewed. The reason we focused on rape was very specifically, if you're charging rape because of the nature of the rape, the definition in law of rape, you know something about that person. If you take out the art and part people, you know something. It's one of the very few crimes which is unambiguously requires a sex. So in a sense, rape is to be generous there. It's unusual, but I think there are questions about other crimes which might then get into what you're describing, which is if there's a inconsistency across systems, it start to get more complicated to chase down. But it's a very good question to have with Police Scotland, because coming back to trust in public statistics, across the whole board of statistics that the police collect, which is an incredibly important statistical set, the consistency of data recording by the police more generally is obviously, for you as politicians, for whom this is data you will work with a great deal, you need to feel secure that what you're being given by the police as an account of the world is reliable, is trustworthy, and that local variation is within the limits that are absolutely unavoidable. So, yeah.
Okay, yeah. Thanks for that. Thanks,
Chowdhury.
Thank you, Convener. Just a question. Do you believe there should be a third party involved rather than the police for recording or response, determining the sex of the person committing it? Do you think there should be a third party involved rather than the police?
I don't understand. Do you mean at the point of charge or...?
At the point of reporting, because what I've heard and what the discussion has been happening is that the petitioner is wanting the record of the biological sex and the gender identity, but if the police is not recording the database, should there be a third party involved?
I think it's got to be the police. I mean, it will come back to our answer to Mr. Golden. If the police are charging rape, they know what the sex is unambiguous of a rapist. If the act, the person committing, they cannot charge rape unless they know the person in question has used an erect penis to rape a person. So there's no third party required at that point who would add anything to the police have done this. Since rape has been on the statute, but they've known this and had to know this. So I think it should be a matter that police have recording practices that are robust in their own right to do that, to as a functional entity, that they need to be able to do that.
So can I ask a couple of questions just in relation to the various submissions we've received in your own? I mean, I note that... in your final submission, you say that the Police Scotland statement remains technically correct. Now, I just wanted to look behind that. Do you believe it remains technically correct because that is convenient or because it is technically correct, if you can understand? I mean, when you say technically correct, do you worry that that is a euphemism for not entirely... responding to the issues that you're raising?
Convener, could you tell us where in our submission...
It's in the last paragraph.
All right.
The last two paragraphs.
Give us a moment.
It says, as we previously argued, while the Police Scotland remains technically correct since Bryson declared a trans identity after being charged. Is that... Are you familiar now where we are?
Yes, absolutely. No, I mean, we think... In 2021, they said there's no such case, and it's technically true because Bryson was at the point of arrest still using his... he was just presenting as a man called Adam Graham, and he transitioned, he assumed his new character in between charge and trial. So it is technically correct that the police have never dealt with a case. I think I have to find... I'm trying to think about it there. It's an angels on pinheads, and the case I know you'd rather I didn't mention involved, but we have, let's say, we have now evidence of a case of a person who had lived in their community for many, many years using a female name, was known around the community, was arrested, dressed in a manner that clearly they were in that persona at the time, and yet the fact that that person was recorded as male was the choice of that individual. So I feel there's an angels on pinheads quality to maintaining the position they do.
And what we have, I mean, you referred earlier on to the way statistics can be manipulated and how a tabloid might suggest that there has been an explosion in a particular area of crime. The statistics, insofar as we've got them from any of the bodies, take us up to 2020. Is it your worry that in the period since then, that the statistics that might be presented will give rise to the type of tabloid journalism that you're to which you are referring? And are you disappointed that there aren't more up-to-date statistics that might confirm or not the worry that maybe you have that what is this evolving practice might be about to have an impact on the way these things are reported and perceived?
We can't and won't know. I mean, this is the thing. Once the data recording practice has been altered, I mean, this is what really troubled us when we went to the Scottish Government to say we've spotted this one female rape in the 2018-19 criminal proceedings data. Their response to us was, oh, yes, that does look strange. We're going to check newspaper reports. This is not a sustainable way of running a data collection exercise. I mean, obviously, we're here talking very specifically about the crime of rape. But if Police Scotland have, for example, ended up recording a number of sexual assaults as being perpetrated by females when they were actually perpetrated by males, well, we won't know that now. Are they going to, you know, if we contact them again, are they going to scour the newspapers, go back on, check whether they've misrecorded something? I mean, this is not sustainable. You know, once you've lost the data and the certainty about the data, you've lost it. So we just won't know. And rape is the most obvious one, as Lucy said. We came to you because, to us, it's an indisputably male crime. Some women do commit sexual assault, but the numbers are very small. But because the numbers are small, the ability to skew is great. And that would go for serious sexual assault as well. But the fact is, they've changed their practice and we just don't know anymore. So it's one of those unknown things.
And I'll just add to that, there was a case in Stranraer. It was Stranraer Sheriff Court, I think, just in the past week. And it was sexual assault, it was groping, indecent exposure, and then internet reach of bail conditions and use of the internet, and the person concerned had been convicted in 2008 as a man, just straightforwardly, of past sexual assaults, but is now using a female name, was recorded in the press statement using female the press reporting I saw, but I think in court was dealt with using sort of female pronouns and so on. So we don't know. That case could well turn up in the sexual offending stats for the current year as a female case. But the only way to find that out later will be to do exactly what Lisa says, which is to comb through the press, which as a former senior civil servant, I find an extraordinary proposition from any government.
Thank you. I think that's very helpful from my point of view as well. If any colleagues get any further questions they'd like to put. Thank you both then for coming. Is there anything you'd like to just say that perhaps you felt we didn't manage to explore in the detail you might have wished?
Yes, there's a statement actually, so I made a note. Yeah, if I could make a note, Karina, I think we're grateful for the conversation. I hope that you will come back to us if there's anything that comes up in your own discussions. Please do. We're very pleased to help the committee with this. I'd like to make a closing comment, if I may, though, Convena, which I would like to say to the committee that sitting in front of you all as a group of, you know, you're all men, you'll be very aware of that, and we're women. Sitting in front of you today is two women talking about the issues and the petition, talking about the kind of things, talking. This is not an experience we would choose. I really want to make that point. This is not normal. Please don't read into the fact that we're sitting here as we are, that we're comfortable doing this. We think Police Scotland, particularly, its unwillingness, but also the Scottish Government to give leadership here, that has made this policy and this petition such a drawn-out process, is a problem. And it's not that neither you nor we, I would say, are being asked to engage here with a normal political discussion. It should not take 2.5 years to bottom out that rapists should be recorded as male. And I'd like to finish there, if I may.
Well, I mean, I understand the point you make, and I understand the point you make about the committee. And I have long experience, obviously. In 2013, women came forward on the transvaginal mesh scandal, and that must have been an incredibly difficult presentation to have to make at that time, identifying what was, you know, not an area of public health policy that had to be discussed in detail. And I hope that the Parliament, and certainly those of us who were men on the panel at the time, did understand and pursue that case very actively on behalf of those women. So I hope we're capable of doing that. I believe we're capable of doing that. But I understand that from the experience then, I've well long understood that some of these issues are very difficult, actually, to have to present and to discuss. So I do thank you both very much indeed for your evidence this morning, and we'll take a short recess just to allow us to reset. Thank you. Our second petition this morning, continued petitions, petition number 1928, to provide free rail travel for disabled people who meet the qualifications for free bus travel. And this has been lodged by David Gallant and last considered by us on the 3rd of May, when we agreed at that time to write to the Scottish Government. And I'm pleased to note the Scottish Government has responded to confirm that the remit of the Fair Fares Review includes consideration of the scope of and extent of existing concessionary travel schemes, including the provision for disabled people and their companions travelling by rail. And colleagues may remember the issue in relation to companions who may have been getting off at one stop where there was a concession and getting off at another where there wasn't. This response also indicates that the review will report by the end of this year, with the expectation that a package of measures will be considered for implementation from 2024-25 onwards. We've also received a submission from the petitioner drawing our attention to provisions of the Equalities Act and suggesting that this legislation be used to compel the Scottish Government to ensure disabled people have equitable access to public transport. Do members have any comments or suggestions? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I would actually like to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government have confirmed that the remit of a Fair Fares Review includes consideration of concessionary travel schemes for disabled people and their companions travelling by rail. And in closing the petition, can I remind the petitioner, if the Fair Review doesn't meet what we're trying to do, we could bring a petition back in 12 months' time.
Yeah. So are colleagues content with that approach? Mr Ewing.
I am content with that approach. I wonder if when closing the petition, we could just draw specifically the attention of the government to the information that the petitioner has provided in the supplementary submission to which you alluded, Convener, of the 13th November, because I thought the petitioner made a very strong point and is one I think should be made to the Scottish Government specifically to be considered in the consultation, namely that at the moment people with a disability cannot actually go by bus for long distances because there's no adequate toilet facilities, according to the petitioners, at least on various well-known bus company vehicles, which are referred to in the petitioner's response. So the point is they can't actually access public transport at the moment on the basis of people without a disability. And therefore, because trains do have disabled-friendly toilets, then the provision of what they ask for would enable them to travel. At the moment, they can't travel at all. And I just wanted to make... I entirely agree we can't really take this much further, given that there's a consultation. So that's really a way to deal with it. But But specifically, that seemed to me to an extremely strong point indeed, and a very obvious form of discrimination against people with disability.
I'm very happy, I think, colleagues, that in closing the petition we write to the Scottish Government, who are undertaking this review, to make that a very point to them in closing the petition. Are we agreed?
Yeah,
we are. Our next petition is petition number 1985 to evaluate garages to homes developments. This has been lodged by Darren Loftus and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to commission an independent evaluation and provide national guidance on garages to home developments. And we last considered this petition at our meeting on the 23rd of February, where we agreed to write to the Scottish Government in COSLA. However, before we move forward, we have received a request from the petitioner, which was received yesterday, asking us to defer consideration of this petition until a later date. We're still trying to establish the underpinning of all of that, but in light of that request, are colleagues content to defer consideration of this petition? We are. Thank you very much. The next petition is petition number 1989 to increase defibrillators in public spaces and workplaces, and this has been lodged by Mary Montague, who I should acknowledge again, has subsequently become the provost of my own local authority in East Renfrewshire. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to support the provision of defibrillators in public spaces and workplaces. And we last considered this on the 8th of March, when we agreed to write to the Scottish Government, the British Heart Foundation and the Order of St John. Now, the petitioner highlights a recent UK-wide survey on the factors affecting public access to defibrillators, which found a strong desire for public funding to support placement of pads, as currently there is a reliance on communities, charities or local organisations. The petitioner has suggested that the Scottish Government make representations to the UK Government to appropriately update health and safety at work legislation with the inclusion of reasonable defibrillator provision in first aid requirements. Now, I thought the information we received on survival rates, I mean, at least a 60% greater chance of survival if there is access to a defibrillator, it really is a very meaningful difference. The Scottish Government's response states that the Scottish Out-of-Hospital Cardiac Arrest Report 22-23 was due for publication in October. However, the clerks have become aware that this publication has now been delayed until later in the year, although there's not much of the year for it to be delayed later in too. I presume it must therefore be imminent. St John Scotland's written submission highlights growing financial concerns among community groups, specifically in relation to purchasing batteries and meeting the rising energy costs. It also shares challenges in engaging with some local authorities, whose response I think is a bit uneven, stating that some refuse to provide the relevant planning permission and then will not enter into a dialogue to address the issues. The British Heart Foundation Scotland has highlighted government funding in Wales and England to assist with the provision of defibrillators in areas of need, noting that it would support a similar programme in Scotland. So, very important health issue here that Mary Montague has brought to the committee. I think some interesting evidence from the various organisations to whom we have written. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Mr Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would consider writing to the Scottish Government to highlight the issues St John's Scotland has identified and communicating with some local authorities, and to ask whether it is aware of any local authorities that have refused to engage with charities and community groups or refused to provide planning permission for pads installation, and if so, why this has occurred, and how it intends to work with local authorities to improve their engagement with charities and community groups seeking to install pads. I wonder if we could also write to the Scottish Government to ask them if they are considering providing a specific fund for the provision of defibrillators in areas of greatest need in Scotland, similar to a fund in England and Wales, and whether it will give consideration to making representation to the UK Government to update the health and safety at work legislation to include defibrillators provision as part of a minimum first aid requirements.
Are colleagues content? Mr Ewing.
I wonder if we could add to the content of the letter to the Government, as described by Mr Torrens, a request that the Government specifically comment on their view as to the statistic to which you alluded, Convener, namely that access to defibrillator increases very substantially the chances of survival. And I wonder, and I maybe I missed this in the papers, But it seems that there's a lot of data from British Heart Foundation's submission on that. And I wonder if it's possible also to identify how many people's lives have been saved as a result of this increased ability to protect and survive. Because it would be very interesting to see if, rather than a theoretical statistical percentage, how many people have actually, lives have been saved as a result of defibrillators. I think that would be quite useful data to access, if they have it, of course. And certainly by asking them, we can ascertain if they do.
Thank you. And I might also suggest to colleagues, depending on the responses that we receive, that this issue might be one that we put on our shortlist of topics that we might take to the Chamber for a debate. I know we're looking for two shorter debates that might be combined for debating time in the Chamber, but it does seem to me to be an issue of some considerable importance. Petition number 1995 to improve support for victims of spiking, which has been lodged by Catherine Ann Mackay, calling the cave. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to develop a multi-agency approach to investigating spiking incidents to ensure victims are given access to appropriate testing and incidents are investigated robustly. And we're joined this morning in consideration of this petition by our parliamentary colleague Claire Adamson, who is with us online. I notice has been faithfully online throughout all of our proceedings so far. Good morning to you, Claire, and I'll come back to you in just a second. We last considered the petition on the 22nd of March, and at that time we agreed to write to the Scottish Government and Police Scotland. Police Scotland has confirmed that victims will always be asked to provide a urine sample when reporting a suspected spiking incident. However, a sample is not collected if the report is out with the 14-day forensic window or the victim does not wish to provide a sample. Senior investigating officers have been appointed within each territorial police division to act as a point of contact for all spiking-related matters and investigations. The Scottish Government's response highlights Operation Precept, a national response to spiking, which includes guidance for officers and staff, and it states that Police Scotland also has a spiking information toolkit, which includes guidance and information for the licensed trade. The response notes that there is no single test that can determine if a person has been spiked, and it is not possible to determine whether drugs found as part of any test were taken by the individual or given to them against their knowledge or will. And it includes by noting that a further roundtable meeting is due to take place with operational partners. Lastly, SPICE, that's the Parliament's independent research body, has produced a summary of Education, Children and Young People Committee's roundtable on the topic of drink and needle spiking from January 2022. And this summary has been attached to the meeting pack for colleagues. Before I ask colleagues to comment further on actions we might take in light of the evidence we received, can I ask Claire Adamson if there's anything she would like to say to the committee in consideration of our petition? Claire.
Thank you very much, Convener. I would like to thank the committee for the opportunity to speak on this important subject. The petition does have my full support. Ms Mackay previously contacted my office and I raised her case with Police Scotland, and she has my admiration for the way she has approached this issue after such a harrowing incident for her family. We know there is a correlation between spiking and sexual offences, and we know the systemic barriers that people face in reporting such crimes. These are wider cultural issues, typically rooted in the tacit societal acceptance of both violence and misogyny. This petition does not speak to those harmful cultural norms, but it is these attitudes which drive the inequity that have made such incidents troublingly commonplace. As policymakers, we must recognise the areas in which we can make an immediate and tangible difference. Other barriers will still exist to reporting these incidents, but confidence in these incidents being investigated should not be one of them. Victims should feel confident that their complaints will be treated with the utmost seriousness. They need to know that their voices will be heard and their experiences will be compassionately handled and rigorously investigated. This is not the current position, as demonstrated by the experience of the Mackay family. Too many people are hesitant to bring cases forward. Our Parliament has an opportunity to change that narrative. In cases of suspected spiking, I share the belief that appropriate testing should be standard because we know that hours following the incident are critical. Further, victims should be directed to holistic emotional support. People in such situations will always feel scared and isolated, and supporting their mental well-being is crucial. Promoting that support more widely will encourage more people to relay their experiences so that these crimes can be investigated and perpetrators will feel the full legal scrutiny for their actions. No one who commits these heinous crimes should feel safe, and their actions should not go unpunished. And no one who suffers because of these crimes should feel that their voice is dismissed. I thank the committee once again for allowing me to speak, and I convey my appreciation for Catherine Anne Mackay and for her dedicated advocacy on behalf of her family. Their work will make no difference to their own experience and the outcome, but it may ensure that no other victim or family are left feeling that incredible injustice. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much, Claire, and for that testimony and support of the petition, which is much appreciated, and on behalf of your constituent. So, colleagues, we've got various responses which we've had an opportunity to consider, and I wonder if there are any comments or suggestions for action as to how we might proceed. Fergus Ewing?
I thought the responses were pretty comprehensive, and particularly from the police. And it's obvious that the police do take this very seriously. And they stress that, and I won't expand on that, but I thought it was quite a comprehensive reply, for which I'm grateful. Nonetheless, I do think that the points that Claire Adamson makes about testing being standard, which the police say, I think, is their approach that they take, is the correct principle or approach. And therefore, I think there's a few questions that I would like to established from the police in view of the responses we've had. Firstly, to write to the police to ask if it keeps a record of instances where a urine test was conducted, refused by the victim, or not practically possible. And the police do refer to instances where it's not practically possible or where it was refused. And secondly, whether it can compare those records, if available, with the number of reported incidents of suspected spiking. And thirdly, how it ensures that precept guidance is understood and followed by police officers across Scotland, so that there is a uniform routine approach that testing is standard. I wonder if we could also write to the Scottish Government to ask for an update on its roundtable meeting with operational partners, as noted in its submission of the 1st of June. Secondly, how it's engaging with pub owners as part of its work to tackle spiking and broader safeguarding regulations for the nighttime industry, inconsistencies in approach by individual pubs due to a lack of specific regulation was raised during the committee roundtable session. And lastly, if it's given consideration to making spiking a specific offence, and this suggestion again, convener, was made during the roundtable discussion that we had. Thank you.
All of those suggestions, I think, are sensible and certainly rise out of the evidence we've received. Are colleagues anything else they wish to suggest? Are we happy to proceed on the basis of Mr. Ewing's recommendations? So we will keep this petition open. Thank again to Catherine Anne Mackay and to Claire Adamson for her work this morning. And we will take forward with the suggestions that have been made by the committee. Thank you very much. Our next petition is petition number 2000. I don't know whether that's statistically significant. It's the 2000 what? I'm not entirely sure, but the petition number 2000. To ensure universities are held accountable to students under consumer law, lodged by Dr. Marie Oldfield, calling on the Scottish Government to ensure universities are held accountable to students under consumer protection law by extending the remit of the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman or creating a new body similar to the Office of the Independent Adjudicator for Higher Education, which could enable students to access redress without the need for court action. We last considered this on the 19th of April, and at that point we agreed to seek the views of University of Scotland and the National Union of Students, also known as NUS Scotland. Now, University of Scotland has responded to state its view that SPSO offers an effective route for complaints handling where cases have not been resolved at an institution level, and it therefore does not see the basis for an expanded remit or a new body to be established. The response also notes new guidance from the Competition and Markets Authority published earlier this year, which provides advice on how consumer protection law applies to the UK higher education sector and what enforcement action is available when higher education providers do not comply with the law. Reference is also made to the Digital Markets, Competition and Consumers Bill, which is currently being considered by the UK Parliament, which is expected to significantly strengthen the Competition and Markets Authority's enforcement powers. Now, NUS Scotland response states their support for a review into the complaints processes for higher education institutions and notes their view that extending the remit of the SPSO would be an effective way of empowering students to hold universities to account, which SPSO itself has no wish to do. We've also received a response from the petitioner expressing concerns about the SPSO's remit and approach to complaints handling and the impact on students of navigating complaints processes and having to seek redress through civil courts. So I think from the NUS and from the petitioner a desire to go further, but from the SPSO and Universities Scotland less of desires to so do. Do colleagues have any comments or observations in view of the responses we've received? Mr. Torrens?
Thank you, Convener. Considering the responses that the committee has received, I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that redress and enforcement aspects of consumer protection remain reserved to UK Parliament, with provision in the Digital Markets, Competition and Consumers Bill expected to strengthen enforcement powers in the competition and market authorities. And the Scottish Government has no intention at this time to seek extended powers available to SPSO or create a new body in this area.
I think that latter point in particular, where the Scottish Government's given very clear direction, means there's limited scope for the committee to advance the aims of the petition. Do colleagues therefore support Mr. Torrens's recommendation? So we thank the petitioner for bringing the petition forward. We respect the fact that the important issues have been raised, but given the response of the Scottish Government, who have no inclination to undertake work to advance the aim of this petition, I feel there's little scope for the committee to proceed and will therefore close the petition. Petition number 2001, which is to withdraw, and I quote, the Supporting Transgender Young People in Schools guidance from Scottish Schools. This has been lodged by E. Phillips on behalf of Safeguarding Our Schools Scotland and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to withdraw the Supporting Transgender Young People in Schools guidance for schools resource and await the outcome of the CAS review before developing a new resource. And we last considered this petition again on the 19th of April, and we agreed to seek the views of a variety of stakeholders. We've received responses from LGBT Youth Scotland and Scottish Trans, both of which oppose the action called for in the petition and highlight the development of the guidance with input from organisations across the education, women's and sports sectors, as well as the LGBT plus sector. While the National Gender Identity Clinical Network for Scotland responded to note that its remit does not include the provision of materials and guidance documents to educational establishment, it is supportive of any guidance which aims to help school staff provide transgender young people with the best possible educational experiences. The response also notes that the CAS review commissioned by NHS England to make recommendations about NHS services provided to children and young people questioning their gender identity has no significance to the provision of educational materials in schools. We've also received two submissions from the Equality and Human Rights Commission, the second of which provides a brief update on its review of the technical guidance for schools in Scotland. It is understood that amendments have been made to ensure references to the protected characteristics of sex and gender reassignment reflect developments in the complex area of law and policy, that latter being a quote. The response from COSLA notes that while it was not directly involved in the development of the guidance referred to in this petition and does not have an agreed position on the guidance, it does remain committed to working with partners to take forward the recommendations included in the LGBTI Inclusive Education Working Group's 2018 report. We've also received response from the petitioner, drawing our attention to the Equality and Human Rights Commissioner's updated technical guidance for schools and sharing information on an NHS England resource that has been designed to help educators support gender-distressed children. A request to provide the committee with written evidence has also been received from For Women Scotland. Well, quite an array of responses in point of fact. So having had the opportunity to consider these, do members have any comments or suggestions for action? And Mr. Torrance.
Considering the likely evidence before us, I wonder if we could close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government is clear guidance to support transgender young people in schools is needed. Withdrawing the existence guidance would be detrimental to the well-being of transgender young people and would leave teachers and schools without national guidance to inform them and support their decisions. And the case review of NHS services provided in England has no significance in the provision of educational materials for schools in Scotland.
Thank you. Are there any other comments, suggestions or variation of view? No, we have a proposal from Mr. Torrance. Are colleagues wishing to pursue that? Yes, they are. Right. Well, thank you. Quite a lot of information. We'll obviously summarise much of that again in our response to the petitioner. Thank them for bringing forward the petition. But in view of the work currently being done, the committee has taken the view that that we will close the petition. We now come to agenda item 3, which is the consideration of new petitions. And as I always do, in case there are petitioners who might be watching our proceedings this morning having lodged a petition, just so that they understand, we initially take a view from the Scottish Government and from SPICE, the Scottish Parliament's independent research body. And we do that because were we not to, then at the first consideration of the petition, that's exactly what we would then propose doing, which would only add a delay to our consideration of the petition. And it's important, I think, that we get to the meat of the argument and case that the petitioner is trying to advance. The first of our petitions that are new this morning is petition number 2041 to exempt community healthcare staff from parking charges. And this has been lodged by John Ronald, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to encourage local authorities to exempt staff working at community healthcare facilities and who don't have access to free on-site staff parking from on-street parking charges and allow them to care for vulnerable and sick people in our country without it costing them thousands of pounds per year. Mr. Ronald tells us that he works alongside healthcare staff based in community health buildings surrounded by parking meters, which has seen an increase in charges to around £6 per hour. Mr. Ronald is concerned about the impact this will have on community-based staff who require use of a car throughout their shifts, particularly in the context of the cost of living crisis. The Minister for Local Government, Empowerment and Planning has responded to the petition, noting that as local authorities are responsible for setting parking charges and property they own and determining who is exempt from such charges, this is not a matter the Scottish Government can intervene in, although I might have argued it was an issue on which the Scottish Government might have had an opinion. The briefing we've received from SPICE also notes the role of local authorities in setting parking charges, as well as highlighting measures for NHS staff and volunteers to claim reimbursement for parking charges and the action the Scottish Government have taken to abolish car parking at NHS hospitals in Scotland, which is of no use at all to the people that we are considering here, I have to say. So, do colleagues have any comments or suggestions? I don't really feel that so far we've had anything that helps this very important body of public service workers at all. Mr. Ewing?
Well, I was astonished at the replies that we've got, quite frankly. And I mean, the starting point, I guess, for us in the work we do is to look and see what the petitioners say and how what they're complaining about. And this petitioner says that parking charges that he must pay and his cohort of community healthcare workers. It's not quite clear if he's an employee or volunteer, I may say, but maybe that's, I haven't read that properly. But in any event, parking charges have increased to £6 per hour. That means staff pay £48 from working an 8-hour shift. A 5-day week, that comes to £11,520. Now, I would have thought, convener, that given that that's what petitioner said, that the Health Minister and NHS Scotland would have commented directly on that, but they haven't. Well, why not? It's completely, absolutely baffling, but also completely unacceptable. And, I mean, the idea that the Scottish Government can pass the buck to local authorities is completely at odds with what happened in September 2008, when the information I have suggests the Scottish Government announced that car park charges should be abolished at NHS hospitals. So that directly contradicts what the Minister is now saying, and I find it absolutely baffling that we'd be asked to accept this nonsense as in any way acceptable. So I do think we have to strongly rebut this, to write to COSLA and to the Health Minister and ask them to look again and ask if it is the case that groups of health workers have to pay these extortionate charges, and how on earth, if that's the case, they can be expected to carry on in their job. We'd be driving people out of this kind of work if that is true. Now, it may be that they question that evidence, and that would be fine. But a direct response, I think, is something to which surely the petitioner must be entitled.
Yeah, and curiously, I see joining us for a later petition our colleague Jackie Bailey in the gallery today. And Jackie Bailey and I should say, worked together on hospital car parking charges in an earlier parliament, where we wrote to the then Health Secretary, one Nicola Sturgeon, and managed, I think, on a joint opposition basis to have hospital car parking charges in NHS-owned car parks abolished. And so there, I think, Mr. Yu, you make the point very effectively that the government has intervened on a matter that it regarded as the ownership of the NHS previously. And I think the key thing for me here is exactly the point you make, that the Scottish Government says it's not a matter for the Scottish Government, but it may not be technically a matter for the Scottish Government, but they can have an opinion on it, and they could show some sort of moral leadership or lead in relation to us evidencing the claim of the petitioner. Because it does seem to me that these are individuals who are community-based, who need to get to the patients or the people that they are seeking to assist in a car. And if, in fact, whether they're back at HQ or they are with their patient, they are then having to pay significant car parking charges, then that is a disincentive to those people actually continuing in the form of employment they are in. And that the loss of that would be hugely detrimental to this valuable service in the community. So I wonder if we could also write to COSLA, the Royal College of Nursing, Unison, Unite and the Allied Health Professionals Federation, actually to see if we can get some further evidence in relation to the statements that the petitioner has made, to understand whether this is a widespread experience or not. And I certainly think we should return to the Scottish Government and say, well, we'd like to understand what your view is on the petition, not just to sort of argue that it's not a matter for you, because clearly it would be a matter for ministers if we suddenly lost all the staff who are performing this service.
Yeah, it was of concern in the good old days, convener.
Well, I'm not going to lead the committee in a chorus of down at the old Bull and Bush, Mr. Ewing, but are there any other comments or inquiries from the... Are we content to proceed on that basis?
I agree.
We are, thank you. Our next petition is... So thank you very much to the petitioner, and we will be taking forward the aims of the petition, as you can hear. Petition number 2043, to change the way gender theory is presented in schools, which has been lodged by Philippa Jackson. And you will recall we considered a similar petition, not exactly the same, just a moment ago. And it's been lodged to urge the Scottish Parliament, to urge the Scottish Government to redefine the relationship sexual health and parenthood, that's RSHP lessons, pertaining to transgender, and not present the information as fact. The Spice briefing note, which has been prepared, states that Scotland does not have a statutory curriculum, as we know. It also notes that the Scottish Government was consulting on draft statutory guidance on delivery of relationship sexual health and parenthood education to replace the guidance currently that is in place. The Scottish Government's response states that it has accepted the recommendations made by the LGBTI Inclusive Education Working Group. Of the teaching resources available for RSHP, one resource contains a lesson on being transgender and is intended for primary 5 to primary 7. Now, this resource asks young people to think about what transgender means and aims to challenge the stereotypes and prejudices that can lead to transphobic bullying. The submission notes that the content of the RSHP resource was informed by over 1,000 primary and secondary teachers and was piloted in 38 schools. And the petitioner's written submission expresses that children are being taught an ideology that she is deeply concerned about, as she finds the current teaching to be age inappropriate and extremely graphic. She believes that some of the people involved in creating the RSHP resource are very biased. And the petitioner states that adults should not be coercing children to think that they can be the opposite sex. So those are the comments that we've received from Spice and from the petitioner, and I wonder if members have any suggested options for action that we might take forward. Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government has clear guidance to support transgender young people in schools is needed. The Scottish Government has accepted the LGBTI Inclusive Education Working Group's recommendations on its approach in inclusive education.
Mr. Ewing.
Well, I wouldn't oppose that because it's very clear that the Scottish Government is not going to change its practice, but I'd just like to record my full support for the petitioner's views in every respect.
Are there any other comments or observations? So, I mean, given the very clear guidance of the Scottish Government and noting Mr. Ewing's comments, which might be more widely shared, I expect, are colleagues content, therefore, to... even though it's a new petition, regrettably close it, given the direction that we've received. We are. So I thank the petitioner for bringing the petition forward. As I hope you will have understood, the response we've received from the Scottish Government means there's little scope for the committee to pursue the petition further, and on that basis we are closing it. Petition number 2046... to provide birth certificates for stillborn babies, which has been lodged by Debbie Ann McMillan. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to enable a birth certificate to be issued in respect of any baby stillborn after 20 weeks of pregnancy. I notice in the gallery this morning is the Claire Hawkey, who is the MSP, I imagine, for the petitioner concerned, and Claire is just observing the proceedings that are taking place. A stillbirth is defined in legislation as a child who had issued forth from its mother after the 24th week of pregnancy and which did not breathe or show any other sign of life. This reflects that a baby born at 24 weeks or over is capable of surviving. The Scottish Government's submission indicates that a change to 20 weeks would impact on this and other legislation, including the limit of 24 weeks for most terminations of pregnancy. The Scottish Government therefore has no plans currently to bring forward primary legislation to change the 24-week threshold to 20 weeks. The Scottish Government's response to the petition outlines the current approach for registering a stillbirth, whereby the Registration of Births, Deaths and Marriages Scotland Act 1965 makes provisions so there is both a birth register and a separate stillbirth register. It also notes that recording stillbirths as births could have wider implications about the legal personality of an unborn child. The Scottish Government has stated that it does not plan to make changes to the way in which stillbirths are registered. It does note that the recent launch of a memorial book for those who have experienced a pregnancy or baby loss of 24 weeks, applicants will also be given a commemorative certificate, which is intended to give recognition and comfort to those who want to record their loss. So, an important consideration, and I imagine most members of the committee will have known people experience matters affected by the petition, but very clear direction, I think, from the government in relation to potential consequential impacts were this change to be made via primary legislation. Do colleagues have any suggestions or comments to make? Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. In light of evidence given to committee by a government and impact on legislation, I wonder if a committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government has no current plans to bring forward primary legislation to change the 24-week threshold for registering a stillbirth to 20 weeks, and does not plan to make any changes to requirements to separate registers of stillbirths and of birth.
Colleagues, content? I think the government's argument in relation to the termination of a pregnancy at 24 weeks really would have to be the primary source of any debate, from which a consequential subsequent action, were any change at some point to be made, might be one that the petition seeks to establish. But in a way, I think probably I understand the government's concern that to move on this area first could have consequential impacts on that legislation, which may not be those that are intended by the petitioner. And so I think for those reasons, it is important that, or I agree that the correct proposal is to close the petition. Colleagues are content with that, yes. That brings us to our penultimate petition this morning, which is petition number 2048. Which is to review the Fast Stroke Awareness Campaign. And this has been lodged by James Anthony Bundy. Petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to increase awareness of the symptoms of stroke by reviewing its promotion of the Fast Stroke Campaign and ensuring that awareness campaigns include all the symptoms of a potential stroke. I should, of course, perhaps say that Mr. Bundy is known to members of the Scottish Conservative Party as someone who has worked in our corridor and whose father died, and I gather that his mother and is with us in the chamber this morning as we consider the petition. In addition to that, we are joined by our MSP colleagues Alexander Stewart and Jackie Bailey for the consideration of this petition. Well, Mr. Stewart is back for his first visit to us since he withdrew his patronage of our committee. And Jackie Bailey, of course, is a very familiar and regular attendee and campaigner on behalf of constituents with petitions before us. And I should also note that we've received a written submission from Sandesh Gulhani, MSP, in support of the petition. James has lodged this petition after losing his father to a stroke that went undiagnosed as his symptoms did not fall within the parameters of FAST, that's face, arm, speech, time assessment. The family are now raising awareness of all the symptoms of stroke, which can also include an inability to stand, cold sweats, vision problems, nausea and vomiting. The SPICE briefing that we've received refers to a 2021 systematic review of evidence, which noted that less commonly used BFAST tests, that is balance eyes, face, arm, speech, time, identified more ischemic strokes than the FAST test, and that this test may play an important role in the diagnosis of strokes. In response to the petition, the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health notes the Scottish Government published its refreshed stroke improvement plan in June, with priority two of this plan committing the government to establish the current degree of public understanding of the symptoms of stroke and whether certain at-risk groups require different messaging. We've also received a submission from the petitioner, which provides further detail on his family's experience and the difference use of the BE FAST test might have made. In doing so, James calls for an immediate and urgent review of the existing stroke awareness campaign to help ensure that every individual experiencing a stroke receives the timely care they deserve. So, an important petition that's been brought to us. And before we as a committee consideration further, I will ask our two parliamentary colleagues if they would wish to comment. Alexander Stewart.
Convener, good morning, and members of the committee. It's a pleasure to be back amongst you, but for the first time at this side of the table rather than the other. Can I also say that I was, in the previous session of Parliament, a co-convener of the cross-party group for chest, heart and stroke. I'd like to speak today on support of James Bundy's petition PE2048, the Review of Fast Stroke Awareness Campaign, and commend James and his family for the fantastic work they've done to date, bringing this petition here and also highlighting where we are. They're calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to increase awareness of symptoms of stroke by reviewing the promotion of Fast Stroke Campaign and ensure that awareness campaigns include all the symptoms of a potential stroke. There have been 11,055 reported strokes in Scotland in 2022, an increase from 2021. Latest data for the year ended 31st of March 2022 reported 3,836 deaths, which were of cerebral disease, including stroke, and the current test to assess patients suspected of having a stroke, as we've heard, is the FAST. While this test can identify most stroke patients, can also present other symptoms which are less common symptoms. And I think the crux of all this, convener, is these less common symptoms that can occur in some individuals. And that may mean that they end up being, unfortunately, delayed in their process. There may be a misdiagnosis when it comes to that. And that very much was the case that happened here with Mr. Bundy dying at the age of 53. In 2021, as you've indicated, there was a systemic review of evidence found that the FAST accurate dedicated support would show that between sort of 69 and 90% of strokes could be identified. But crucially, the test missed 40% of the posterior occlusion strokes, which is exactly what Mr. Bundy suffered from. The issue that we have here has also been identified by the National Advisory Committee on Stroke, stated that important that it was education for health professionals, including in circumstances where there is a negative test for stroke. And I think that's what we talk about here as well, this education that's required for the professionals who are dealing with the situations and circumstances are important. So I firmly endorse all the calls that James Bundy and his family are putting together to the review of the FAST test, which was carried out in evidence sessions. And there should, I believe, be an evidence session that would be potentially brought towards the Health Committee and the potential for a debate in the future. This would help the opportunity to carry out where the family is and how the process is moving forward, because it's quite clear that in this circumstances, that test was not fit for the purpose to identify. And it is very important that we try to alleviate that for the future. So, I commend and congratulate the Bundy family for their terrible loss they've had to suffer. But it is their wishing to support individuals and others who find themselves so that this will not happen to other families. And as I say, I'm very supportive of the petition and delighted to be here, convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. Jackie Bailey?
Thank you very much, convener. And of course, both you and Mr. Stewart have covered most of the detail of what I was going to say, but just a couple of points of emphasis. I think we would all acknowledge that FAST is a very good awareness programme for strokes, but it could be even better. And I think that is at the essence of this petition. I have to say the petition, when I read it, is simply common sense, convener. And I'm not sure why the Scottish Government isn't doing this. We've heard why James brought the petition to us, and it's a matter of regret that his father died in the way that he did. It is the case, as we've already heard, that 40% of ischemic strokes are simply not captured. And symptoms like vomiting, blurring of vision, confusion, lack of balance should be included in an extended FAST awareness campaign. And you yourself have referred to BFAST, which covers balance and eyes. So I would ask the committee to urge the Scottish Government to conduct a wider review of FAST. Of course, we recognise the good work of the FAST campaign, but if we're missing up to 40% of ischemic strokes, then surely we should be open to changing the campaign to include more symptoms. The Minister's response, I think, misunderstands this point, but what I would ask the committee encourages her to do is to build on the solid foundations of FAST, but extend it to include more symptoms so indeed we can save more lives. And that's an objective I'm sure everybody signs up to. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Jackie Bailey. I think, obviously, this is an important petition, and I too applaud James and the family for the work they've done in bringing it forward to us. And I too was struck, as Jackie Bailey was, by the fairly straightforward action that could be taken and promoted, which could have a material difference. So I think we will certainly want to return to the Minister, but I wonder if there are suggestions of action we might take in the interim period. Mr. Torrens?
If I could convene, I wonder if the committee would consider writing to the Stroke Association and the Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland to seek reviews on the action called for in the petition. I wonder if the committee would also consider writing to the Scottish Government to seek clarification on what consideration has been given to using the BFAST model to help raise awareness of symptoms of stroke.
Yeah, so I'd very much like us to pursue that with the Minister, I think. And in many respects, I would like to think we could embrace the language of Jackie Bailey and all that, that it seems to be fairly common sense in this instance. And as much as anything else, if they have considered it and have chosen not to, what reasons they might have for having come to that conclusion, because I think that would be assist us further in the way that we might pursue the issues raised in the petition. So, again, I thank James for bringing forward this petition. It's an important consideration. We'll keep the petition open, obviously, and we will seek the information that we have requested and return to it at a subsequent date. And I thank my parliamentary colleagues for joining us this morning. Thank you. That brings us to petition number 2049 to introduce buffer zones outside migrant accommodation. That's our final petition this morning, and it's been lodged by Gillian Petrie. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce buffer zones outside migrant accommodation to prevent anti-immigrant groups from gathering in these spaces and help protect occupants, including asylum seekers and refugees, from harassment and intimidation. The petition has been prompted by concerns about demonstrations taking place outside hotels being used to temporarily house refugees and asylum seekers, with Gillian providing examples of demonstrations targeting accommodation in Erskine and Elgin. The Minister for Equalities, Migration and Refugees has responded to the petition, highlighting the Scottish Government's previous engagement with the petitioner and the need to establish a clear definition of migrant accommodation, as well as consideration of the purpose, risks and benefits of creating buffer zones. And given the complexity of these issues, which I imagine are considerable, the Minister has asked officials to undertake an initial scoping of the potential feasibility of this ask. The Minister also notes existing powers available to Police Scotland to deal with any serious disorder arising from public assemblies and encourages anyone who has experienced or witnesses any form of harassment or hate crime to report it to the police. do members have any comments or suggestions to make? Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider writing to Scottish Refugee Council, Just Right Scotland, COSLA, Police Scotland and the Mayor's Group to draw attention to the Scottish Government's initial view and to seek your views on the actions called for in the petition.
Are we content to do so? We are. Thank you very much. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. We'll next meet on Wednesday the 20th of December. And we now move into private session to consider items 4 and 5 as we agreed earlier.